Thank you for joining me for Basic Macros. In class today, we're going to learn how to create macros either by the recording feature or by designing them using a programming language similar to Visual Basic. But as this is intended to be a basic class, we will primarily focus on the recording tool as that is the easier way to work with them. We'll also take a look at editing the macros and how to use them and make them accessible within your Office products. Now, before learning how to create these, it's important to understand what is a macro. A macro is a time-saving device. It's something that you create to automate a task or usually several tasks for you to make them happen quickly, usually at either the click of a button or the press of a hotkey. This can be done in a number of different Office products. We're going to focus today on Microsoft Word and Microsoft Excel as the two primary ones that we would use. There are different situations where you'd use macros. The most common ones in my experience are either where you have a repetitive task that needs to be done a number of times throughout a file. Often we have this come up in Excel documents where we have a large number of entries that each need to be updated in a specific way, and rather than doing the five or six steps for each entry, you can change it to one simple macro that you would run for each entry. Or you have something that you frequently do and you want to be able to apply to a number of documents in the future. This is something we use more often in Microsoft Word, where we have, say, formatting changes that we like to apply, or blocks of text that we want to be able to insert at the press of a button, things like that. So we're going to go over all those different ways to create macros and how they would be helpful for you. Now with that, we're going to be using the Office 2016 products that I have here on the computer, but everything that we do will work very similarly, if not identical, going back to Office 2007, and most of it would work before that, but the main difference that you would see is you would not have the ribbon at the top of the page that we associate with Office 2007 and newer. So with that, let's start talking about some general macro ideas and getting ready to record our macros. Let's take a look at the screen, and I'll show you how we got to the macros management section here. You see there's nothing in it right now. I'm going to cancel this and go back to the home screen that we're used to in Microsoft Word. If I go to View on the ribbon across the top here, and then click on the pull-down arrow next to Macros, I have the choice View Macros and Record Macros. Once I've begun recording it, then the Pause Macros view will be option will be available, and we'll see that in just a couple minutes when we work together on this. First, let's view macros. This is where you would come to see anything that is active on either the computer or the specific file that you are working with. And we'll talk about when we save these things, where they are saved, whether they are part of the file that you're working on or the computer itself. Now, right now you see there is nothing listed here because we have not created any yet. As we go through this class, we're going to add several of these to this. You see the create and the organize options here, and you see macros in all active templates and documents, normal.m, that is the global template that would apply to all Microsoft Word files on this computer, Word commands, and document 1. Document 1 is the name of this blank document that I have just created. That will change when, of course, we save this and name it. Typically, I will recommend .m there when you are saving things in Microsoft Word so that you can reapply them for future files that you will work with. We'll see that as we go through it. I wanted to show you this here blank before we start adding things to it. Now, before we record our first macro, one thing that I want to talk about with the general ideas is that it's really important to understand what the macro is actually doing if you want it to work correctly. What I mean by that is you want to be very, very aware of the specifics of what you are doing when you are recording. Say I wanted the title of my document here to be highlighted and centered and then underlined and make the font size 14. Now, I could do that by holding down the shift key and moving the arrow to the left 16 times, and that highlights the entire row. After I do that, I could go to the Home tab and I could click up a size until it got to the size that I wanted, and then click center, and then if I wanted to, underline it. And had I been recording, that would have recorded all of those steps. Now, the problem with that is that when I go to reuse this in the future, I am going to have problems because not every title is going to be exactly 16 characters long. And the upsize is going to not work if my sizes were different than what they were before. So you want to learn to be as general as possible when you are creating these things. So instead of doing the steps as I did them there, I'm going to use the undo button to take a step back here. What I will show you, oops, undid once too far there, is you would first click the home button. I know you can't see what I'm typing, but I'm pressing the home key on the keyboard. So no matter where the cursor is, that will take it right to the start. Then when I press shift and end, that goes all the way to the end of the line, no matter how long the title is. So you see, in that way, I've bypassed worrying about the number of characters in the document, or sorry, in the title that I am trying to change here. Then I would specifically change the font size to 14. And then the underline and the center buttons work the same way as they did before. Although you could use hotkeys for those as well if you preferred. That's just one of many examples of how you're going to want to be as general as possible when you record these things so that you can reuse them. There's no point in creating a macro that you can't use over and over again. You're just adding extra work for yourself if you do that. So you want to think about these in the terms of how they could be applied to as many situations as possible. This also brings up an important point. Macros aren't going to work for everything. Once you get the idea of saving time and not having to redo your work, it might seem like a great idea and something that you could use in a lot of different situations, and it is. But there are some situations that are going to come up where it's just not going to be able to be applied because it's always going to be too specific. You're going to have too many fields that you need to fit things into or that you need to simply look at to click in the right place, and it won't work out being automated. So for that reason, we do have some issues with having to pick and choose our spots for where the macros will work. Now, with that being said, let's go ahead and record our first macros. So let's record our first macro. I'm going to follow those same steps that I just showed you. Before I do that, though, I'm going to go to the pull-down arrow here in the View Macros choice and click Record Macro. Now, when you do this, it opens up a screen asking what you want to name this. I'm going to call this Title Formatting. We always want to give our macros somewhat descriptive names so we can identify them when we see them in a list. You notice here that I don't put in any spacing or punctuation. That is preferred for the macros names. It will work better for you that way. In the description, I'm going to talk about what this macro does. I'm going to say formats my class titles as I prefer. Now you see where it says store macro in. This is what I talked about a little bit earlier when we looked at the menu. Right now I have this selected stored for all documents. normal.m. The normal.m is a file that Microsoft Word uses to find commands and information about it. Other things you might find stored here would include the spell check dictionary. Just a little aside with that. Generally speaking, if you can store your macros there, I recommend doing so. The only situation where you would not want to do that is if this was, say, a public workstation that you went from computer to computer and you wouldn't necessarily have the information there when you came into work tomorrow. Then you might want to have it specific to the file that you're working with. But normally we make these things with the intention of using them with multiple files, and so you'd want to store it on your computer so that you could use this again with any future documents. Note that if you are working in the cloud with Office 365, then the situation for this would be a little bit different, and that would be a specific thing that we would work with learning about working on the cloud. Now, assign macro to is a big one. This is how you would quickly access the macro. You can always get to them through that menu that I showed you before. So if you forget to do this or it gives you trouble, that's okay. You can still use the macros menu in a way that I will show you in a minute. But if you want to make it more convenient, you can assign these to a button and or a keyboard shortcut. For right now, we're going to put this on a keyboard shortcut, and I'll show you later how we can always add these things to a button if we are so inclined. So I click on the keyboard option here, and it's asking me to, it says commands, normals.newmacros.titleformatting. That's the name that I just gave it, and this is the category that these things fall into. Right now, current keys, there are no keys assigned to this. It says press new shortcut key. I know you can't see as I'm pressing, but this I'm going to do this for a title, so maybe I would do Control T. And it tells me that's currently assigned to a hanging indent. If you're not familiar with hotkeys, there are a lot of built-in hotkeys for Microsoft Word, such as if you press Control B, that turns bold on, Control U turns underline on, Control Shift and the greater than sign makes your font bigger. So lots of things that you can just press on the keyboard and it will make things happen. If you are creating a new shortcut key, there's a chance that you might be replacing something that is already in there. Now, a hanging indent is not something that I use all that often, certainly not so often that I would need to have a hotkey for it, so I might be okay with replacing this with my title formatting that I'm going to put assigned to this right now. On the other hand, if I decided I didn't want to do that, I could delete this and I could try something else. Maybe Control-Shift-I. Nope, that's italics. I don't want that. Maybe Control-Shift-N for name. That's currently assigned to normal style. I could say, oh, I don't really care about that, but the Control-Shift-N is a little bit hard to remember. I'm going to go with Control-Shift-T. Ah, before I just did Control-T, Control-Shift-T is unhang. And if that's definitely not something that I'm worried about because I don't move the indents back and forth too often, I can say, yes, that hotkey will work well for me. In case I lost you in the details with this, what we are doing is we are assigning this macro that we are about to record to work with a simple series of keys that I can press on the keyboard, so I won't even need to go through the menu. So I'll be able to simply type something in and then press these keys and the effects will take place. So I'm going to stick with Control-Shift-T and I'm going to click Assign. Now once I've done that, the current keys are filled in there. I could assign more if I wanted. Maybe I was worried that I will forget the capitalization. So I can do Control-T as well, and I can assign that, and that way I have both of them there. Once I'm done assigning things, I will press Close, and now it's ready to record. So at this point, I'm going to follow those commands that I gave you before, again, being as general as possible while making sure I get the effect that I want. So I'm going to say this out loud because I know you can't see as I am typing. I am pressing the Home key, because I know that will bring me back to the beginning of the line. I am pressing Shift and End to highlight this. I am pressing Control E to center that. I could have used the ribbon as well, but I just used the hotkey for it that time. I'm pressing Control U to underline, and then I am going to go to the Home tab and change the font size to 14. And just for fun, I will also make it bold. And maybe let's change the font color to dark blue. Now, I am going to go to View, Macros, and Stop Recording. Notice the Pause Recording option. That's if I wanted to not record what I was doing, but not end the macro. So maybe I wanted to change what I was looking at or think about something or test something out. I could pause recording and run a quick test, and then I could start the recording again. This time, though, I'm pretty confident I want to stop the recording. So I stopped that, and it seems like nothing happened, but we are in fact done. And if I go to View My Macros, I can now see Title Formatting is an option that I have available. Now, we'll go into running these and stepping into them in just a moment. But before we do, I want to go down here, and I want to show you a different way that we can record a macro. I want to record a macro for inserting text that is commonly used. So in the past I've shown people how to do this with a return address. I'm going to continue with the theme of creating my classes here, and I'm going to say Instructor Sean Luster is something that I type in frequently. But I also like to have that on the right hand side. So I'm going to again record a macro. So I'll go to View, Macros, Record Macro, and I will call this one Instructor. Put in instructor information. And I will again, well, this time let's add this to a button. So I'm going to click button and I will select normal new macros instructor. And this is something that I am going to show you a little bit later on, some more things that we can do with, but we can add this macro to anywhere in the ribbon that we like. A very common place to add things is into the Quick Access toolbar, which you see up here in the upper left. Typically, we don't have too many things in the Quick Access toolbar. By default, you have the Save, Undo, and Redo options available there. Sometimes people add the Print button if they want to be able to get to that quickly. In the past, working here at the library, I have created a macro for a lot of staff to use for a standard formatting thing that we use for sending out notifications to people, and I have added that as a little button on the macro for all of them to get to right away. I don't think, in actuality, that this would be something that I would use so often that I would want to have it there, but just to show you how that works, I am going to add this to the Quick Access toolbar. And with that one selected, I can choose Modify, and I can put in whichever little picture I want here to make it fit a little bit better in this space. So say I just put in the eye for instructor, say OK. So now I will say OK, and it is now recording, and I am going to go to the home button, right alignment, and type in instructor Sean Luster. Now, note that the formatting came out exactly as the formatting already appeared from the previous changes that I made. However, I did not record anything to make the formatting look that way. So when I use this in the future, it will not take on those attributes that were there. It will just go with whatever formatting is currently in place for Microsoft Word. If that's a little confusing for you, it might make more sense when we actually do the demo in just a moment. So I'm going to now stop this recording, and I'm going to close this file, and I'm going to open up a new one, and then we'll take a look at how the recording takes effect. So let's use those macros on my next example class. So the first thing that I'm going to do is type in my title here, and then when I go to the next line and I want to put in the instructor information, instead of having to type that, I'm simply going to go up to that information button that I put at the top of the screen, and when I click that, there it appears. Notice that it takes on the formatting of the line above it. For those of you that haven't used Office very often, you might not know, but it tends to retain whatever formatting has been last used, whether it's from the previous text box, if you're working with a publisher or programs like that, or if it's from the previous cell, if you're working with Excel. In Microsoft Word, it just keeps using it as you go through here. For that reason, you want to be careful not to make all of the big changes to this before going on to the next line. If you did that, then you would have to turn all of those changes off, and that would undo all of the time saving that you would gain by using the macro in the first place. So make sure you go on to the next line before applying the macro that does a whole bunch of changes, as we're about to do, and even if it's just a blank line, then that will have the simple formatting that was already built in. Now I move my cursor back into the organizing email section here, and I'm going to go to the View menu and take a look at my macros, which I can get to simply by clicking on that button. And I'll select Title Formatting and Run. And a lot of effects take place right away. You can see the size was increased, it was underlined, it was made bold, it was centered. It highlighted the entire line, so we can see that change took place. Now you might be wondering, what happened that it didn't retain the color change that we made? What happened is there are some things that you can select simply by clicking on the mouse and the menus that won't work or won't be retained when you are recording the macro. This is either because there's something a little bit fuzzy with the selection. A good example of this is when you are looking at the colors. There's just such a wide range of varieties here that it doesn't pull that in very well. We do have options, though. When we go into the programming of these, you can control it manually, either by giving specific color names that are built in or by selecting colors that are there. So we're going to edit that together, and we're going to see how that works using the programming language that is provided for you working with this. Now, to get to that, let's go back again to the View macros. And when you select either of these, I want to talk about some of these other options that we have here. Run is what we just did. That's actually making it happen, making it take place. Step into is an option that you have to walk through the macro one line at a time and step through it. This is a debugging tool that you would use. If you're not familiar with that term, it's a technique that's used to try to figure out where the errors or the problems are with your code. So it's going to walk line by line through until we can see what went wrong. This can be useful for macros because they tend to be incremental things that we add step by step as we go through this. Edit will simply show us all of the code for the macros. This is good to use even if you are not going to make any changes to the programming language. By the way, that programming language that we're going to see is called Visual Basic for Applications, or VBA. It is something that's used universally in Microsoft products. It's relatively friendly, and it's something that you can learn by finding a lot of tutorials online. If you don't want to search the internet too thoroughly, I would recommend that you can use the programs through the library's website called lynda.com. If you go to our website and go to online learning, anybody that has a card at the Bloomingdale Library can use that. If you're not a Bloomingdale Library member, then perhaps your local library would offer that as well. But lynda.com is a great resource for online education that we provide here for you, and that has classes on VBA, as well as things that you can find on YouTube or other tutorials online that might be helpful for you. Create is something that you would use if you wanted to create one from scratch. In that case, you would need to put in a new title for this. So you would call this, and then you could click Create. Now, I don't want to do that, so I'm going to go back to here. Delete, you might guess, is to get rid of a macro if you no longer wanted to have that. And the organizer allows you to choose how you arrange these or choose where they are stored. Let's go back to looking at this. So let's take a look at the code that we have for our macros and how we would think about editing them. So I'm going to take a look at what's in there first, and then I'll show you some changes that you can make and things that you can put in as we go through this. As I mentioned at the start of the class, this is intended to be a basic class introducing you to the concept of macros, so we're not going to dig too deeply into this, but I do want to show you how you would look at this and how you would make changes as you go through and sort of explain the code that you've created. So I'm going to select the title formatting one and click Edit, but you'll see when I do this that you'll see the code for all of the macros that we have stored in this location. So when I click Edit, that brings up this screen. For those of you that aren't familiar, this is something that you would see in a lot of programming scenarios. And you can see on the left-hand side the directory. This is in the normal files for Microsoft Word, in the modules, new macros. And so here in the macros, we see title formatting. The parentheses indicates that this is a function that is performed. The single dashes here indicate that this is just a comment telling you what this is about. Title formatting macros formats my class titles as I prefer. You might remember that as the description that I typed when I was writing this in, and this is the name of the macro. So this is stuff that does not affect how it works, it just lets you know what it is you're looking at. This is the actual code that makes it go. So these are all the commands that take place when you are running this. The reason that I tell you this and that I show you this, even if you don't want to make changes, is if you go to the trouble to record something and you find it useful, it's not a bad idea to come here, copy and paste this or perhaps all of your macros, and put them in a Microsoft Word document or a Notepad document or whatever it is, an email to yourself, it doesn't matter, just so you have it in case something happens to this computer or your computer at the office. So if you go to the trouble to make a lot of macros that save you time, store them somewhere that you won't lose them. As I said, store them in an email or a cloud storage location, document stored in your Google Docs or Office Online, someplace where if they change out your computers at work or your computer at home breaks or whatever might happen, you don't lose your work because these things can be relatively complicated and you might want to save them. So now let's take a look at the code that we have here and what it does. So for the title formatting, first thing it says selection home key. So that means that I pressed the home key. So that's the key on the keyboard that jumped me to the beginning of the line. Then I press the N key and it says extend. That means that I was highlighting across that. So I highlighted across the end of the line. So you remember me doing that from a couple minutes ago. Those are the first things that I did, and this is how the code looks to indicate to the computer what I did there. And it says selection paragraph format alignment. So it says align paragraph center. So that is a command to align the paragraph to the center there. After that, we did the underline. Now, the underline is interesting because the underline is what we call a toggle. It's something you turn on and turn off. But it's slightly different than the bold toggle that you turn on and turn off because you see a couple lines later on, the selection font bold is a toggle that it can only go one or two ways. It's either on or off for bold. But the underline is a little more complex because there are different underline settings that are available. So if I had done something more complicated and changed it to, instead of underline single, we could make this underline double, and it would turn that on or off as we went through this. There are other underline choices and formatting options that are available there. So they give you an if-then. It means if the selection font underline equals none, then change it to single. If it does not equal none, so if there is an underline, then change it to none. So this is going back and forth, but it gives us the option to change this value. I'm going to copy this just to be safe here. And I can save that, and now I can try this effect and see how it works differently. So you see, even if you're not a programmer, you can just learn from the code that's written here and make little changes and try it out. Will this necessarily work? Not sure. Let's test it and find out. If it does not, what I would do is I would go to Google and search, how do I, using Visual Basic for Applications, change the underline options? And I would see my different choices and selections that are available there. Now down here, selection font size, we changed that to 14. If I decided that wasn't big enough, I could change that to 16. And we already talked about the selection font bold for the toggle there. Underneath here, we see the other macro that we created, instructor, and that's, again, the title that I put in is instructor macro, and then the description I put in is put in instructor information. I could put in here for classes. That would still work as a comment. I just put in more information. And then here you see it says, I moved the alignment to the right. You might remember me pushing that to the right-hand side at first. And then I had it selection.typeText, and the text equals instructor Sean Luster. If I had typed an entire paragraph, we would have just had that entire paragraph of text there. Whatever you typed while it was recording, that fills in. Now I'm going to save my work here. Close this. And let's try running this again. So I'm going to, again, view the macro and run title formatting. And look what happened. It turned the font size from 14 to 16 because we made that change. And it removed the underline because that underline, again, was a toggle. And it removed the bold because the bold was a toggle. Let's try running that again and see what happens. And now look, double underlined. So you see, using the code, we can be a little bit more specific or change things around. We can also do more complex things as we learn more about programming and creating these Visual Basic for Applications functions that we want to make. Now that we've recorded a macro, edited it, tested them out, and learned to use them in different situations, let's talk about how we can make them a little bit more convenient to get to. Now, we've already added something to the quick access bar there, and we've talked about creating keyboard hotkeys for them, but if this is something that you want to use frequently, then you might want to customize the toolbar. So we're going to go to the customize the toolbar options in just a moment, but before we do, since we are talking about the quick access bar here, I do want to mention the undo button. Those of you who have used Microsoft Office for a while are probably familiar with the undo button as a great time saver and a quick way to get back to where you were just a moment ago if you made a mistake or you tested something out and you didn't like the results. I want you to be aware, though, that when you use a macro, that is not something you can simply undo with one click. The macro is read as a number of commands for the undo button to undo. So however many commands were built into the macro, that's how many would appear in the undo button. And if you see, when I click on the pull-down arrow here, a whole lot of choices that we would have to go back through. So the more complex your macro is, the more likely that you won't be able to jump all the way back through it with this undo button here. See, I can undo several of these things, and you see some changes there, but not everything has gone away. Oh, I was able to undo all of that, and then I can redo step at a time through there. So it depends how many things that you have put in. But just be aware that running a macro is not a single application for the undo. It is multiple things you would have to click through. Now, with that being said, let's take a look at the Customize ribbon. If you haven't done this before, we get to this by going to the File menu, Options, which is where you would find general options for things like your saving location for whenever you save files, where those go, that would be under here, for your language controls, for this for proofing, if you want to have spell check running automatically, things like that. A lot of useful stuff here. I would encourage you to explore this. But for today, we want to talk about customizing the ribbon. So here's where we would go to edit the options that are available for us on the ribbon here. Just a quick note, even if you are not using macros, you might want to come here and change this if you use Microsoft Word or any other Office products frequently to make it a little bit more convenient for yourself. Tired of having to go to the file menu every time you want to print? Well, you can toss that right into the home menu if you're so inclined. Lots of things that you can do, lots of ways that you can work with this. Now, today we're going to add our macros to the ribbon, and we have two different ways that we can do this. For one, we can create an entirely new tab across the top of the ribbon here. We would do that by, as you might guess, clicking New Tab. And I could select this and rename it. And I can call this Macros if I like. So I say OK. And then in the group, I can rename this if I want. The group is the name that you see. If we're looking at the tab for Home, the group would be the name like font. And I could make My Creations, or whatever I wanted to call this, is the group option, group name there. I say OK to that. Now, what I need to do is select what I want to put into this tab and group that I have made. So to select that, I could go with the popular commands that we have here. I could go with all the commands that are available, which you see there are quite a lot of Microsoft Word commands that you can go through here. So if you're ever feeling adventurous and you want to see what might be helpful for you, by all means explore. But for today's purposes, we're going to go to macros. And I could grab normal new macros instructor and add that. And then I could grab the title formatting and add that. And now I have two things here. Now I can select one of these things and I can rename it. And that is, of course, a rather long name there. So I could say type instructor. And if I want, I can choose a different symbol for it to be consistent. I could choose that I so that it's the same as the one up at the top there. I say OK. And now I can select this. And I can rename this one. And I'm going to select that symbol because it looks kind of like a title. And I'll change this to just say title formatting. And again, I could choose whatever symbol I wanted for this. And I say OK. And now when I say OK, you see I have a new option macros right there. And you can see My Creations. And if I click Type Instructor, that appears. Title formatting, that happens. So I've created those. And I could go back and customize that and add more things to this. If instead of macros, I just wanted to call this My Favorite Tools, I could have macros here, then I could have the formatting changes that I make most often and the things I insert most often. You can put whatever you want in the ribbon and you can make it as convenient for you as you like it to be. So if you are spending a lot of time working with the macros and creating these sorts of things, I would recommend you take a few minutes to make this easier to get to and more convenient for yourself. And while you're there, have some fun with it and add anything that you'd like. I hope you found this to be a helpful introduction to working with the basics of macros. If this is something you'd like to learn more about, please let us know. I'd be more than happy to do extended classes on working with Visual Basic for Applications or any topic related to this that you might be interested in. If there's anything else you'd like to see, let us know. We're always interested in new class ideas. Hope you come by the library with any questions that you might have and use our online resources whenever is convenient for you. With that, thank you very much and have a great day.